Hey folks, today I thought we could break down the Sierra Ferrell and Billy Strings collab that dropped recently. It's Bells of Every Chapel. Billy takes some great breaks on it. Super cool kind of country western 3/4 tune. It's a throwback. Definitely check it out if you haven't listened to it yet. Really cool to hear Billy Strings in that context. He is not that kind of player. He is a bluegrass player, and so he kind of solves all those problems in bluegrassy ways as opposed to particularly country ways, which is always fun to see. Now, before we get into the big break, I do want to show you a couple technique things. Really important to learn the nuts and bolts of this style of music if you want to make more of it, because you likely weren't born and bred into it. So it really helps to know just a tiny little bit of that technical information. Remember as well, the tab will be available on my website, lessonswithmarcel.com. But before we look at that tab, we're going to talk about this technique stuff. So let's jump into a couple scale shapes and a couple double stop shapes that are going to make learning this break a heck of a lot easier. So let's do that first. All right, so the first thing I want to show you is a C major pentatonic scale. And when I say that, maybe you're thinking of like the A minor shape, that box one. It's also C major. It's not what we're talking about. We got to do it down here by the open strings. Now, it's not going to be just that C major pentatonic scale. I'm also including the dirty third, just this idea that if you transition from the minor third to the major third, you get this cool bluesy effect without it being too grating on the ear or anything. It's not just blues. It's kind of this sweet blues sound, and that's the dirty third. Take a second. Look at the scale. Now, the next thing I want to show you is the full C major scale. Billy doesn't use this a whole lot, but I believe he does use it over a G chord, so it's kind of like G Mixolydian or something. But to us, we're just going to think of it as that C major scale. It looks something like this. Go ahead, take a look. Continuing on, I really want to show you these double stop shapes. Now, in both of Billy's breaks, he has these alternating passages that sound like this. And he's using double stops to accomplish those, right? They're like little parts of chords. There's a C major bar chord. He's just using that little part to create that effect. So here are three double stops that we're going to see in Billy's breaks, especially in the second break. Go take a look. The next thing I want to show you is a C major diagonal pentatonic shape. Now, we already did a pentatonic scale, but this one moves diagonally across the fretboard so we can ascend the neck if we want. Country guitar players do this a lot. This one kind of looks like this. And we'll see Billy do that, I think, right at the beginning of his second break. Go ahead, learn that scale, and it'll help later on. With all of that good stuff out of the way, we can now do a breakdown of the whole tab. So we're going to pull that tab up and let's walk through this thing. Now, the first thing you'll notice is we do have a kickoff phrase. So before the form of the chord changes starts, there's a pickup that Billy plays and it sounds like this. And that C note is B1 of the actual form. So that starts on an upstroke, downstroke pull-off, and then downstroke on C again. If you were going to count that, we're feeling beats 1 and 2 before we come in. 1, 2, and 3, and 1. Of course, this is in 3/4, right? No beat 4. let's keep going. So starting on the first measure of the actual form, we have 1, 2, and 3, and 1, 2, 3. That's not too tough to play. Of course, Billy is thinking about this C shape. I wouldn't be surprised if he's playing this with his hand roughly in a C shape, or at least with his index finger down. Something like that. Now, this is when we get our first double stop, right? Our first double stop is over the C chord. It's this first shape that you would have learned, and they're triplets, which means that we're rocking back and forth between these downstrokes and upstrokes, and they're going to reverse every time. As in normally with eighth notes, we get down, up, down, up, down, up, and that fills a measure just fine. But with the triplets, we have down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Since triplets are groups of three, the pick strokes don't divide evenly, which will create some problems later on, you will see. So this pattern, we have down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. And of course, you don't actually want to, you know, show distinction of those patterns, but that's what's happening. Down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. That's what that sounds like. You'll notice your hand really wants to be on the outside of those strings. So if this started on an up, it would be uncomfortable, right? Up, down, and my pick is kind of in between the strings. I don't want that. I want my pick to be on the outside. Hopefully that makes sense. So moving on to that next measure, I have this. 1, 2, 3, and. Make sure that slide is nice and fast this time. You'll notice too, if you're familiar with alternating pick strokes in a bluegrass setting, that the first pick stroke we have on measure 4 of the real form there is an upstroke. That's a little awkward. It's not ideal, but it's going to happen when we have triplets like this. Anyway, that whole line again sounds like this. Let's move on to the next line. This next line sounds like this. Right, first measure, nice and easy. 1, 2, 3. Our second measure might give you some trouble. We have pre-bend, release, bends, but we also, they're also double stops. We have a note on top. So I'm holding down first fret on my index finger. I'm holding down third fret on my B string. That's with my middle finger and my ring finger. I'm only going to bend up my B string, and then I'm going to let it down. You hear that sound? I'm also playing that hybrid picking, right? I'm using my middle finger on my pick hand to play the high E string, and I'm using my pick on the B string. You don't have to do that. You could just strum it. The thing that you don't want to hear in a situation like this when you're dealing with pre-bend releases is you really don't want to hear the note being bent up again. So I don't want to hear. That's not what I want. I only want to hear the note come down. Which you'll probably find a little challenging. Last measure. Which leads us into the next line, but this measure, it's a bunch of eighth notes, all down, up, down, up, down, up. 1, 2, 3, 1. I think we can move on to the next line now. Next line actually has quite a bit of eighth notes in it, which will make it a lot of fun. We'll also see the return of that double stop shape. It's a little sneaky, but you'll see it. So the first measure is kind of a play on the Lester flat run. We're doing it over a C chord, not a G chord though. It sounds like this. As opposed to. Like you do in 4-4. So it's kind of truncated so that it'll work in 3-4. And that next measure sounds like this. That's moving into the next line a little bit. But you can see how that's kind of our double stop shape again. Certainly not playing it like a double stop, but he's imagining the C chord back here when he plays the Lester flat run. And he's imagining the C chord up here as he continues. That makes sense? So those two measures together, I'm also going to play the bend, sound like this. Now, when that bend happens, we have the note that we initially play. The note that we bend up is the next eighth note, and then we have these eighth notes that follow it. So you can think of it as 1, 2, 3. The fourth measure on that line too. This bend, you'll notice, I'm not really trying to get it particularly in tune. It's kind of a banjo sound effect, at least I associate it with banjo players. And a lot of times banjo players don't get it perfectly in tune either. It's almost just like a sound effect. The note curls and it doesn't perfectly get in tune. When you're playing quickly, it doesn't really matter. It's a great example, right? Playing that line just a little bit quicker, that bend, you don't really notice that I didn't get it perfectly in tune. So don't stress about that. Let's go to the next line. This is the last line of this break. And we'll see that Billy is playing over a 2-5, right? Major 2 chord, major 5 chord. So D major and G major. Over the D chord, he's going to play kind of a D arpeggio. It sounds like this. Watch that quarter note at the end of that first measure. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Now, over the G chord, like I mentioned earlier, it's a C major scale. Later on, it kind of becomes, you know, C major pentatonic or something. You might look at it like that, or G major pentatonic. But the important thing is right at the beginning of this, he's kind of giving us like a G mixolydian feel. We're getting the dominant seventh and the sixth of the G chord. You can look at that as just a C major scale too and save yourself some headache. But the line sounds like this. One and two and three and one and two and three and one. I almost said four. Four doesn't exist. And that is that whole first break, the first half of the first break. And then a fiddle takes over, another instrument takes over. So the second break also has a kickoff, and the kickoff happens on the and of two, just like our first kickoff. So one, two, and three, and one. Now, Billy is going to recreate that timing again. So he's going to come in on the and of two once again, but now he's using the diagonal pentatonic. So one, two, and three, and one, two, and three, and one. See how there's kind of a symmetry with those lines? You feel that? Make sure that you're getting that right. When I play this diagonal pentatonic, I'm sliding with my pinky, and then I'm barring with my index finger. Now I'm gonna slide on my ring finger, bar with my index finger. Right there, I slid with my pinky twice. Don't do as I do, do as I say. There you go. The second half of this line has this slide that doesn't really go anywhere. So I'm sliding from 12 to 10, but it doesn't, you don't really hear the note that the slide goes to. Sounds like that. You can feel this like a handful of quarter notes, right? Because you're just playing downstrokes on the beat every time. So that's one, that's two, and this triplet pull-off, right? 10, 9, 8, that's B3, and that's B1 of the next measure. Now, if you think this note sounds weird, it is the dominant seventh of the C chord, and we're about to go to F, so it's like C7 going to F. It's a voice-leading thing. Doesn't really mean a lot when you don't have a rhythm player behind you, but that's what's happening. Two, three, I'm ready for the next line. Before we do that, let me play this whole one for you. Two, three, there's that whole first line. Let's move to the next line now. So now we're playing over a D chord, and Billy's gonna start it with kind of a Doc Watson C lick, and then he's gonna start caring about the F chord a little bit. It sounds like this. That's a really classic Doc lick, and it's something Billy does all the time, too. He's playing a variation of that. And of course, these last two notes, part of an F chord, right? Our next measure has some crazy stuff. If you want to cheat this a little bit, make it just a little bit easier, you can do a pull-off for that whole first triplet. You can get three notes out of one pick stroke. Then I would play the rest as written. So triplet, beat two triplet is down up. Beat three isn't quite a triplet, it's close, but he kind of rushes those first notes. I kind of feel like that. There's the first three measures. Now in measure four, this is what I was getting you ready for with this triplet talk. We have to start this triplet line on an upstroke, and it makes everything that comes after it on the next line much easier. So know that the next line starts on second fret of the D string. And I have up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. And that would be B1 of the next measure. Now, if you wanted to start it with a downstroke, you'd have to play two downs, two ups later on to fix it. And I find this just much easier to play. So that whole line. Rest, rest. And then we get a downstroke on B1 of the next line, which is really convenient. So let's move on to that next line. Next line looks like this. It's the first three measures. I'll play it again. Now, we're getting some rests on downbeats now, which can be a little tough to feel. You might feel it with like a head nod or a foot tap, but we're going to have missing eighth notes. You can see them in the sheet music. They're tied over. So I'm going to say the word rest, but know that you could probably do that with a foot tap or something else. It sounds like this. Rest, rest. It sounds like that. Rest, rest. And that is the syncopation in that measure. If you just want to feel it, I'll play the second two measures a couple times. Sounds like this. If I counted it traditionally, one and two and one and three. So B3 is missing and then B2 is missing in the next measure. Let's do this last measure. This is the one that's going to give everyone trouble. I already know. So remember I said if we're going to be playing these double stop ideas, we're going to want our pick on the outside, right? It's tough when our pick is trapped between two strings, but when it's on the outside, it feels much easier. That means we have to start this pattern on an upstroke. Also, notice my face in the demo performance of this. I kind of miss it, and I thought it was funny, so I left it in. I hope that's good with all of you. So, getting into this, I'm doing the D triad that we learned. It's up here, and I'm thinking triplet, 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 triplet. And in the middle of the second measure, I think where I wrote it, he's switching that fifth fret to sixth fret. It's kind of like, you could think of it as like a diminished passing chord or something. There's something funky happening right there. It's a chromatic walk. Maybe just think of it as a chromatic walk up to the G chord, and it makes more sense because we're going to get to that G triad up there too, right? So in the middle of that measure, I'm switching so that my middle finger is down on the high E string on sixth fret. Triplet, triplet, triplet. Or down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. That's going to feel real weird. I know it is. And when I play it, I don't think really carefully about when that finger comes down, actually. I just know that somewhere in that second measure, I got to put that finger down. And then we take that shape and we just scoot it up for the G chord. He does his first two triplets like that. Triplet, triplet. The last triplet, he's going back to where he was. Triplet. And then the last note of the break is this singular note. It's the dominant seventh of the G chord, and G7 is about to go to C, so it's this transitional note. It might not sound good when you're playing on your own, but if you have another guitar player, it'll make a lot of sense. So that whole line together. I think I counted that right. Let's try again. One, two, three, one, two. So it is, and as you speed it up, you find yourself counting and caring less. If you wanted to speed it up real fast and just do a tremolo, that wouldn't hurt either. I wonder if I can demo that. I'm not very good at that. Right? You could even do something like that where you're kind of just strumming back and forth, and you'd get the same effect. I don't think you'd hurt any feelings. That would work for you. So with that breakdown out of the way, I'm going to show you the footage of me playing both breaks along with Billy Strings again. I'm going to put the tab up overhead and you can practice along with me and Billy. Remember that you can also hit the settings wheel and you can change the playback speed. So if you want to slow it down to something like half speed or something a little more reasonable, no one will blame you. I certainly slowed it down when I was practicing this. All the triplet stuff is quite quick. Anyway, have fun doing that. Remember, you can get the tab for free at my website, Lessons with Marcel. Have a good time. Your heart will never be All right, gang. Hope you had a good lesson with me, the biggest, baddest billy goat in the barnyard. I love talking about these Billy Strings breaks. This one was an especially fun one because it's a little bit different. Remember, if you want more Billy content, you can check out the rest of my channel. I also talk about all your other favorite bluegrass guitar players like Tony Rice and Molly Tuttle, Brian Sutton, Trey Hensley, all those good names. Also, if you have any interest in the IBMA Guitar Player of the Year Award, you should check out my last video, or maybe two videos ago, something like that, where I broke down all of the nominees for this year, and I talked about who I thought might win it. Anyway, you all have a wonderful day. Don't forget to check the website for all your bluegrass guitar needs. I'll see you all later. Have a good one. From the mountains cold, we ring the bells at the crossroads. The valley below.